Hello, welcome to our service for the 14th Sunday in the season of Trinity. Hope you've had a good week, and I hope you've been enjoying some of the dry weather that we've been having. Let's begin our worship today. Devoted to one another in love, honour one another above yourselves, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervour, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before the foundation of the world, God chose us in Christ to be a holy people, to be brought into a unity in Christ, to be full of love. The glorious grace of God, freely bestowed on us in the Beloved. Heavenly Father, all hearts are open to you. No secrets are hidden from you. Purify us with the fire of your Holy Spirit, that we may love and worship you faithfully. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So let's keep a moment of quiet to remember our failings and to be sorry for them before God. Have mercy on us, O God. For we have sinned against you. Show us, O God, your mercy, and grant us your salvation. May God our Father pardon and deliver us from all our sins, and grant us the grace and power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So this is the collect for this week, the 14th Sunday in the season of Trinity. Almighty God, whose only Son has opened for us a new and living way into your presence, give us pure hearts and steadfast wills to worship you in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. Realizing that their father had died, Joseph's brother said, "What if Joseph still bears a grudge against us and pays us back in full for the wrong we did to him?" So they approached Joseph, saying, "Your father gave this instruction before he died. Say to Joseph, 'I beg you, forgive the crime of your brothers and the wrong they did in harming you. Now therefore, please forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father.'" Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also wept, fell down before him and said, "We are here as your slaves." But Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Even though you intended to do harm to me, God intended it for good, in order to preserve a numerous people, as he is doing today. So have no fear. I myself will provide for you and your little ones." In this way, he reassured them, speaking kindly to them. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, Not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and the payments be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves, who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, Pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, Have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he should pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, You wicked slave! I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he should pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20. One of the biggest problems with reading chunks of the Bible as we do each Sunday is that the readings can often and easily be taken out of their true context. The verses we read are truthfully part of something more and often refer to things which have gone before or which are to be explained later, and the meaning or explanation can be completely lost because they're not part of what is to be read. This causes even more problems if you're reading several of the stories of the Old Testament, which go on and on for chapter after chapter. And this is true for the story of Joseph, part of which we read this morning. It is a story that's become well known to us since Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice transferred the story from the pages of the book of Genesis to their musical, Joseph and His Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, which has been translated into many languages. But it's very easy to forget that the story of Joseph and his colourful coat goes on for some 15 chapters in all, and if we read every bit of it, we'd be there for hours. It's worth reminding ourselves about the story of Joseph. A man called Jacob, also known as Israel, has 12 sons, and the youngest one is his favourite, Joseph. They are a family of shepherds, and one day in front of their father, Joseph accuses his brothers of not doing their work properly. He grasses on them. In spite of this, Jacob continues to dote on his youngest son and gives him a coat of fine cloth, which was to become a colourful coat, including all the colours of the rainbow. Joseph wasn't exactly popular in his brother's eyes, and then when he starts to have dreams which tell him that one day he will be better and higher than his brothers, this is just too much. It does not please the other brothers at all. Joseph really has become too big for his shoes. So the 11 kidnap the baby of the family, tear his coat from him, and sell him to a passing tribe of Ishmaelites who are travelling to Egypt. The brothers fake Joseph's death at the hands of a wild goat. Joseph is sold on as a slave and then lands up working for a man called Potiphar, and is then thrown into prison after Potiphar's wife tried to persuade Joseph to lie down with her. In the prison, Joseph demonstrates that he has not lost the ability to prophesy and to interpret dreams. Once Pharaoh starts having strange dreams and nightmares, Joseph is sent for to fulfill the task. Joseph does just that and is then given the job to prepare Egypt for the plenty and the famine which he foresaw in Pharaoh's dream. The famine comes and also affects Jacob and those back at Joseph's family home as well. And so the 11 brothers come to Egypt looking for any food that they can get their hands on, totally unaware of the position that Joseph has now gotten for himself. Joseph recognises them straight away and tests them out in several ways before he forgives his brothers and reveals his identity to them. The elderly Jacob comes to Egypt to be reunited with his favourite son so they can be happily together forever in Egypt. A nice little tale which has forgiveness as the very essence of the story, but which needs to be told so that the sentence with which I began this sermon can be seen in its true context. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. Joseph's brothers did something awful, but God worked through it. If Joseph hadn't landed up in Egypt when he did, who knows what might have happened, and how many people might have died from starvation, including his own family. Joseph was the right man, in the right place, at the right time. Not a coincidence, but God working through the situation, which would then require Joseph to exercise forgiveness. This is not the only biblical example of something good coming out of something bad. Remember the start of the Acts of the Apostles? Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest. That's Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, verse 1. Saul had been the number one enemy of the Christians. He was a Jew on fire with a mission who was then converted. God forgave him and then enabled him to go on and become the most important saint in the history of the church. Without Saul or Paul's witness and without his letters, the church would not be here as it is today. Paul realised that what he had done as a Jew was sinful and not right. He realised the truth about Jesus, Saviour and Son of God, and went on to do immeasurable good to the Christian cause. How many times has this happened to us in our lives? We've decided on a course of action, which we believe that God wants us to do, and suddenly we discover that we are doing something totally different, the complete opposite of what we were expecting, something that we had never expected to be doing. This is the sort of way in which God works through us all, you and me. In the sacraments, in our worship and in our everyday lives, God comes to meet and influence our lives. And forgiveness, our need for it, and our need to administer it, is at the very heart of our relationship with God and other people. Much good is rooted in forgiveness. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good. We should never allow ourselves to be surprised at the different ways in which God works through us, even if things do work out totally different to how we expected. Joseph and St. Paul are excellent examples of this. And let us never forget the importance of forgiveness in our lives and in our world. Joseph had to forgive his brothers to be reconciled to them, and so be reunited with his father. Paul had to receive God's forgiveness before he could begin his ministry as a giant of the Christian faith. Jesus emphasised the central place of forgiveness with his parable in our gospel reading today. And so we need to be definite that forgiveness has a central role in our lives and witness as Christian people, every day of our lives, so that God can effectively work through us. Amen. Let us pray. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Almighty God, grant that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Guide the people of Wales and all nations in the ways of justice and peace. Cleanse prejudice and selfishness from our hearts, and inspire us to search for the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Teach us to respect the earth as your creation, that we may use its resources wisely to your glory and for the good of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours. May we serve Christ in them and love one another as Jesus loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Through your Holy Spirit, comfort and heal all who suffer. Give them courage and hope in their troubles. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear us as we remember those who have died in the peace of Christ. May the risen Saviour give them a share in his joy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let us remember all those who continue to suffer from COVID-19. Let us give thanks for those who continue to care for them. Almighty and all-loving God, we pray to you through Christ the Healer for all who suffer from coronavirus COVID-19 here in Wales and across the world. We pray too for those who mourn the loss of loved ones. Give strength to doctors, scientists, health carers, and those who provide for our communities. Give wisdom to policymakers. Give comfort to those in distress, the lonely and the weak. Bring a sense of calm to us all in these days of uncertainty. As we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who show compassion to the outcast, acceptance to the rejected, and who loved those whom no one else would love. Amen. So we share the words which Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. The Lord our God is the only Lord. We shall love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength.
God of the universe, when you raised your servant Jesus, you made him the light of the nations. May the salvation he brings us shine out to the ends of the earth, and may your name be blessed for ever and ever. Amen.
May God bless us, keep us from all evil, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen.
Thank you for being with us in our service today. Somebody else wanted to be with us as well. We have now started services in all of our buildings. We're moving around a little bit, and if you feel it's safe to come and you'd like to, please do feel welcome. And please do give us a ring and we can tell you exactly where the services are going to be. You do have to ring it beforehand to book a place, but we can explain all of that to you. So, from Bobby and myself, until next time, every blessing. Ta-da!